We are tonight's entertainment.
You will never find the more wretched hive of scum and villainy.
Excellent!
Hello, everyone, and welcome to an episode of the Movie Mania Podcast, where we talk films past, present, and future. I'm Sherman Trey White of Podcast Media, and joining me is the man, the myth, the legend. He liked Deadpool way more than I did. Bandit Incorporated. Do-do-do-do.
What? Hello. Here we are once again.
Yes. Yes.
This week covering the 90s reference fest that is Deadpool.
Yes, the movie that will just definitely get me some hate comments if I'm not careful. So,
yeah.
How you been, Bandit?
I didn't know you disliked it that much. Wow.
I didn't dislike
it. This will be interesting.
We'll get to it. Yeah, we'll get to it. How are you?
I'm good. I'm very good. Update on the dog attack from last week. I went around the house next time I was walking, and the whole house was completely empty. Like, all the furniture's gone. And there was, a trailer in the front yard where the people looked like they had stuff loaded up to take to the tip. And I found out from some of the neighbors that they were actually moving out of the house when the dog attacked me, that I kicked in the face. So I don't need to worry. They're all gone.
Oh, I'm thinking they're meth dealers or something. Like, my mind, maybe they went to Breaking Bad. And I don't know, for some reason, I hear, you know, that I don't know, this seems real suspicious. It's like, we can all have dog kickers in our neighborhood, and they just left.
I thought about it. I was like, actually, that makes sense, because that's probably why their dogs were sort of running around, because they were moving furniture out and stuff. But, right.
They could just get a kennel for their dog, you know.
A house on the corner is like the neighborhood busybody, this old lady who knows everyone's business. And one time, she told me all about it. She's like, oh yeah, they're horrible people there. We're all glad to see him go. And I'm like,
wow.
Oh, good.
Well, that's not very nice. Okay.
So I'm glad I kicked their dog. Deserved it.
Oh. Oh, okay. All right. Well, the dog didn't deserve it, but anyway, yeah, the lady's still mean to me, by the way. You know, I'll occasionally wave at her and she'll still give me a bad look, but I feel like she gives that look to everybody. Anyway, if I sound tired today, guys, it's because I'm a little tired. I won't lie. A lot of Game of Thrones watching. Watched a pretty mediocre film today. I won't lie. I'm worn out.
You're into the Skype call too.
Oh yeah. It's it's 8:45 where I'm at, but I'm gonna push through because I like this podcast and I love you guys, even if you don't like me.
Especially all you, right, Praise Arjibor, our official number one traitor.
The official traitor of the
we
podcast.
Love you, Praise.
I don't, but he does. That's okay. That's all right.
Because for anyone who doesn't know what we're talking about, you guys know we have the traitor segment each week where we collect all the hate comments towards Trey or whoever. We did one on the Fine Brothers last week. And our number one, the guy who's been most active in hating Trey, I was talking to him in the comments. And I was like, you know what? He's stuck with us even though he doesn't like you, Trey. And that's really cool because he's like... in a way, that's more devoted than just your regular listener that likes both of us, because he has to push through. And I thought, that kind of dedication, you know, deserves some kind of recognition. So I went and I custom-designed a little thumbnail he can use for his YouTube page that says Traitors, and it's got the picture of Finn fighting that Stormtrooper guy, and I've stuck your face, Trey, over Finn, so it's like him doing
picture.
Battle with you. So if you check the YouTube comments, you can see... Guy there with that thumbnail, that's our official number one traitor. Good job, Praise.
Yes, we are praising you for hating on a black man. Good job. Just like the 50s. Just like the 50s. Well done. You'll never hear any praise from me. But I'm sure Bandit's having a jolly good time having you read his hate comments. And I can't wait till you cross the line so I can finally ban you. Just drop that N-word all you want, and then you're banned.
Well, based off his Facebook picture, he's a black guy too, so...
Exactly, so he's allowed all the more incentive. Well,
he's allowed to drop that word.
I won't get political. I don't believe that, but I won't get political here. anyways. Bandit, we had some... Let's get to the movie news.
Sure.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention? I've just been handed an urgent and horrifying news story. Cannonball!
All right, so DC might be in some trouble. I'm not sure if you heard about this. I think his name is Drew McWeeny of HitFix, and this comes from a reliable source, God Collider. You know, he's been saying that, you know, some of the people that have seen Batman v Superman and the reception is very mixed, similar to what Man of Steel said. You know, they're worried that, you know, DC, once this movie comes out, and it'll make a lot of money for sure, you know, but the reception may not be as good as they want. It's not what they're hoping the movie's going to be. You know, so they're thinking maybe they might have to go in and try to, not necessarily soft reboot the franchise, but kind of like put it into a.
Listen, DC, I'm hoping this movie will be good because I want to see this universe get set up. But if worst thing happens and it's not good, please don't try to retcon it. Don't try to redo it again. Just swap out the creative team behind the camera and just keep going. Just keep going. Don't try to do it again.
They say, and I quote, I would be surprised if Justice League starts shooting when they say it's going to. I would be equally surprised if Zack Snyder returned to direct it. My guess is what's going to happen is that Justice League is going to get moved back and the Ben Affleck Batman movie is going to end up in that spot. Not the ideal situation for DC. But like the main thing with the DC Cinematic Universe right now is the fact that Zack Snyder is helming it. And I even said that back when the Wonder Woman thing came out. I'm like, it looks like a Zack Snyder movie. And I think DC should do the right thing, and that is remove Zack Snyder from the director's chair. Yeah. Get other filmmakers to make these movies.
Yeah, I agree. I absolutely agree. I mean, look, because just this morning when I was going through some of my comments, yeah, because I heard that news myself, and people are like, haha, see, these trailers are proving you wrong. It's going to be the best movie ever. I was like, I think we need to see it first before any of us can decide whether it's the best movie ever or not.
Deadpool had great trailers.
Yeah, well, actually, there's a YouTube channel called Beyond the Trailer, hosted by Grace Randolph. She's fantastic. Yeah. I love Grace Randolph. Don't always agree with her opinions, but she always, you know, expresses them very well. But she said that one thing about Deadpool is kind of links in with like other stuff we talked about, that because the internet kind of saved that and really got that going, because the studio wasn't sure whether or not they were going to do it, then the leaked footage went and it came out online and the internet loved it so much, and because Ryan Reynolds wouldn't give up, and now it's doing really well. People are really liking it.
Yeah.
And she said, well, like, if you take a look at that, but then you take a look at how Batman v Superman is kind of done online, it's not like, yeah, Batman v Superman is a mixed bag of reception.
Yeah, like. And I think that's only because Man of Steel is a mixed bag.
Yeah.
And this looks a lot like Man of Steel meets Watchmen. And there are people that don't like Man of Steel and Watchmen, so people don't know what to think. And, you know, this movie has kind of had a bad rap since it was first announced. Like, even back when it was announced, Batman v Superman, we were all just like, oh my God. I remember I was freaking out. I was like, dude, guess what's next? But then again, like, right away, people were like, well, maybe they should develop Superman more. Maybe they shouldn't just rush to Batman right away. Yeah. I'm just like, no, what are you talking about? We'll get a Superman sequel. Hold on. No.
That was all of our reaction, wasn't it? And because I remember as well, like, before that announcement came out, all the buzz and all the talk was when people were talking about what they want to see next. I remember Screen Junkies did a video specifically on that. Nobody said they wanted to see Batman versus Superman yet. Nobody. Everyone was like, yeah, we'd like one more solo Superman to really sort of solidify him as like the Superman we know, where he can be the core of the Justice League. Maybe see Brainiac, Lex Luthor that's actually good. And actually, people said we didn't want to see Lex Luthor.
We said no Lex Luthor, no Zod. Give us some villains we hadn't seen, like Brainiac.
Solidify Batman, Superman, and build from there. And
I mean, you made a video about some villains that you wanted to see, like maybe the Injustice League or some people like that a while ago. Like we were all having these ideas. I was fine with it though. I loved it. I think, I don't know, maybe because I was a comic reader, I'm like, dude, this Dark Knight Returns, man, we could do this. But
yeah. But following on from like what we're saying with like the relationship between Deadpool and the internet, where it really helped to sort of hone the movie to what people wanted. Because like, I mean, I'm assuming like movie studios, they have like, they talk about test screenings and test audiences and all this sort of stuff to get an idea for what people want. But the problem with that is even like a test audience, the kind of people that go to that are not necessarily, you know, very accurate representations of your regular moviegoers, because they're usually more fans. So, like, if you want a test audience, it's much better to just gauge it from, like, the internet's reaction.
Well,
I mean, granted, not always totally reasonable either, but
I was going to say
it's more reasonable than getting a test audience.
I think a lot, and I know, and I listen to a lot of podcasts, and the only reason I listen to so many podcasts and I read so many things is because I want to stay in the now of things. I want to be able to formulate my opinion on certain things, and so I listen to a lot of different. There's this one podcast called Meet the Movie Press. In which one of the people on there named Jeff Snyder, he's a film reporter. He reports things. He's the one that breaks the stories that you see on IMDb, like, you know, Jason Momoa cast Aquaman. I mean, he's the one that releases those kind of things. And he talks about how it's kind of weird because he's able to see all these movies so early. He's able to talk about these movies, and he's kind of pretentious. Who am I saying? He's really pretentious. And, like, he's the person you think of.
Huh? Well, who isn't, right?
But he's one. But he, I feel like we're like sitting at a water cooler. And he's like, but who isn't, right? We're all just like, ha, 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 ha. No. But it's like, you know, he's the person you think of when someone says movie critic. You think of someone like Jeff Snyder,
yeah.
And which isn't a bad thing. He has some really nice opinions, and he clearly is an outspoken kind of person. I think that's how I'm using that word correctly. But he's not a superhero fan. And so it's weird that they always send these kinds of people to go out and see these movies early. Like, I think he saw Age of Ultron like a month and a half in advance. He's seen all these movies early, you know. He got a chance to see Star Wars before the premiere. And it's like, so what is it that – and that he's not a fan of these things. And so I see what you're saying when in terms of, you know, different audiences are not supposed to be going to these test screenings. And I don't know. It is a weird thing. Yeah.
But I guess, like, hopefully, like, what Warner Brothers will learn out of this is, like, yeah, maybe, like, if they'd paid more attention to, like, all the people online who were saying what they wanted and it was nothing like Batman v Superman, perhaps they should have actually just paid more attention to that rather than just have Zack Snyder walk into, like, the boardroom and go, well, I guess the next step is Batman, right?
Which I have no problem with you did say, Batman.
I do, because I'm like, no, the next step is not Batman. He should be the last step, because it's only a couple of years ago that we had Dark Knight Rises, and really Batman should be the last one to join the Justice League. So really you should add everyone else, and then Batman last. That's what you should do. But
now, you know. I'm not saying that it was the best decision. I think you're right in terms of what the best thing to do was to make a Man of Steel sequel, and then maybe, like, you know, I think – I don't know if it was you or Weekly Planet, but someone made a suggestion about how, you know, you do the Man of Steel sequel and you make it about, you know, you make it about Brainiac or whatever, and then you do a third one where you can maybe put, like, Wonder Woman or some other Justice League member in it, and you slowly build to the Justice League. But I think in terms of what they needed to do as a studio, we as the online fan community may think, you know, DC, don't rush to Marvel, don't try and be the next Avengers, because you don't have to be. But if they didn't do that, the regular average movie-going public will watch these movies, and they will think that they pale in comparison, because while Captain America's Civil War is becoming a thing, we will have just gotten, if the timeline kind of works out the way I think it would have, we would have just gotten our second Superman movie in our DC cinematic universe, quote unquote. And if they got Zack Snyder to do that and they got the same creative team, who's to say that movie would be just as poorly or mixedly received as Man of Steel was? So instead, you know, so I understand where DC's coming from. We're like, yeah, the next step is Batman, because Batman is what we can do really well, as we saw in the trailer that just came out. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And like, yeah, that's right. And in the report that you said, I think he basically hinted that if it doesn't go well, they'll maybe keep Ben Affleck as Batman and just go back to Batman again.
Which you've been calling for years. Like, everyone online's been like, well, if this sucks, they're just going to make them Batman movies for the next 10 years, which I don't want to see them do, because they're doing Wonder Woman. So what happens to Wonder Woman then? Are they just going to be like, sorry, Wonder Woman, close production, no Flash movie, no Aquaman, even though Aquaman looks really cool and they got James Wan to do it, no Aquaman. I'm like, what do you know? Oh, okay, I'm sorry. Do you want to talk about that trailer that came out? That's the next news story. That's the last news story.
The final Batman v Superman trailer?
Yeah, the trailer that showed way too much. What do you think about it?
Oh, I thought you were going to bring up the Daredevil Season 2 trailer.
Oh, I didn't see it. I don't want to watch it.
I only just saw it, but we'll talk about it next week, but it looks pretty good.
I don't want to watch it. I want to go in as fresh as possible.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
it's just because, like, with TV shows, it's like, I don't want to, because if, like, a movie, it's 2 hours, and so, like, okay, I know the basic plot, but with TV shows, especially, like, with Game of Thrones or something like that, it's like, I don't want to go in and have something not happen in this episode, but I know it's going to happen late. Like, say, like, someone's in danger in episode 3, but I know they're not going to die because I saw something in the trailer that hasn't happened. So I want to go in as fresh as possible is my thing.
All right, cool. Well, I won't tell you anything, but yeah, there is only one thing that maybe it kind of spoils the trailer. Okay. At the end of the trailer, but most of it's just introducing Punisher, you know. But anyway, you want to talk about the last Batman v Superman trailer?
I wasn't a fan.
Really?
This movie's losing me the more and more it goes on, because it's showing, it's like playing a card game, and it's like, well, I got this Joker here, and I got these three aces. I'm like, and then I'm like, keep them in your hand. Show me your fours and your twos, but don't, I don't want to see, they're showing me too much of this Batman Superman fight.
A page out of Force Awakens book.
Yes.
And I can't believe I'm saying that, but the marketing for that, of how they didn't show Luke and how they kind of did the switcheroo where you think Finn is going to be
Force Awakens. Sorry. Huh? I caught that little stab at Force Awakens there.
Oh, okay. I think I missed it. But like the marketing of like where they didn't show Luke and they did the switcheroo where you think Finn's going to be the guy, but really it's Rey. But I'd like it if Batman v Superman was a bit like that. Like you say, don't show us all your cards. Even though these kind of movies are not that hard to predict, it's a little bit of surprise is good.
Yeah. But you can still make a surprising film, like, you know, Guardians of the Galaxy pretty much showed us not necessarily the movie, but they showed us the basic plot, you know, these guys who have been saved the world, but they were able to put so much things in the movie that they didn't show in the trailer. Like, if DC was making Guardians of the Galaxy, they would have shown Dancing Groot in the trailer. You know, they would have shown Peter Quill's dying mother in the trailer. They would have shown the best jokes in the trailer, because they would have put 40,000 trailers, each 3 minutes long, each with new footage. They're going the Sony route with this, and it's making me kind of upset. I didn't need to see the fact that Batman has the exact same shoe that he has from the comics. I could probably predict that. I'd like to see that shot in the movie. You're already giving us one iconic shot from Dark Knight Returns, and I didn't want to see that either. Yeah. Look, the trailer's cool. I don't like it. It's showing too much.
Yeah, and it's like, and we already know they're going to have two confrontations, because one Batman's in the battle armor, the other one he's just in his regular suit. Okay. You know, we know there's going to be different. We know about Doomsday now.
Yeah, and we know about Darkseid now. Awesome, thank you.
Yeah, and Darkseid as well. Ugh. Just, yeah.
I guess Darkseid's going to be the Thanos of this, again, bringing up Guardians. I guess Thanos is going to be like the, you know, we're going to cut to Apocalypse. That's going to be weird, man, to like cut to Apocalypse in the middle of Batman v Superman. It's just going to be like, well, what do you mean? What, and Wonder Woman's like, something's coming, and he's like, what's coming? And then boom, Apocalypse. So first of all, it's going to be spelled weird. So everyone's going to be like, what is this? And you're just going to see aliens around, and you're just like, what am I watching? You're just going to see this gray guy and just like, you know, fine, I'll do it myself. And I'm like, this movie's making me angrier than angrier.
Yeah, you're right. That whole dream sequence, nightmare stuff with Darkseid, leave all of that out of the trailers. All of it.
And
leave
it sucks.
All of that out.
Sorry.
Leave Doomsday out. Leave, you know, and don't keep showing us all these different clips from the fight, you know?
Yeah. It sucks because it all looks great. Like the 50-second teaser that they revealed before they showed that spoilery trailer back in December, where Clark pulls Bruce's cowl off. That's awesome. It shot really well. It looks like Zack Snyder-y, but it still looks like a comic book, and I loved it. And it was like, oh man, it's really intense. You know, some of the stuff in the trailer is really intense. Like when Bruce Wayne's running into the building, like, man, that's great stuff. Lex Luthor, I can give or take, but it looks cool, I guess. But the thing is that, you know, you're showing us all your money shots.
Yeah, you're right. Like you bring up that bit in the desert, how cool that scene is where he comes and pulls off the cowl. And you think, how cool would that scene have been going in the movies if you didn't already know about it?
Exactly.
You'd be like, whoa, this is amazing. Now when you see it, you're going to be like, oh, it's that bit I saw already.
Yeah. You know? How cool would it have been if we saw the Batmobile bounce off of Superman in the movie? And it's like, and
yeah,
I could hear the comments now. It's like, well, then just don't watch the stuff that they released. I'm like, no. no, that's not fair because DC's releasing it so people can talk about the movie. Yeah. So they want us to watch it. They want us to watch the stuff that they're releasing. That's not
true.
Fair.
They release it so that because they want us to talk about it. Yeah.
Look, I loved Man of Steel. I think it's a great movie, and I love the Dark Knight movies. But please, can we have some humor in this movie? The movie's looking pretty humorless. Like humor that's not meant for 8-year-olds, please. Can we just get humor that's not meant for Max Landis? Like, I could just picture him, you know, watch the movie and be like, typical Mary Sue, and just like taking his notes and ready to criticize it on Twitter. I'm so nervous for this movie the more and more I think about it. But then maybe I'm going to go in and be like, oh man, the movie was wonderful. But I'm going to come out and be like, yep, it's exactly what I thought it was going to be. All right, Bandit, that's all the news we got here today.
Okay.
All right.
Apologies to Batman v Superman fans. It sounds like we're being totally horrible about it.
It's not their fault. It's the marketing of Warner Brothers' fault for getting us not excited for the movie. Yeah, because that Comic-Con trailer is amazing. So
it is. The trailers are pretty good. It's just, you know, I just wish they'd cool their jets a bit. They don't have to show us so much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. All right, Bandit. So we had some homework.
This week, each one of you has a homework assignment. You're going to go out. You're going to start a fight with a total stranger. You're going to start a fight, and you're going to lose.
All right, so, Bandit, we had some homework. Do you want to go first, or should I go first?
Well, because you're going to talk about Game of Thrones, that usually goes longer.
Okay.
So why don't I cover mine first? First of all, a lot of our listeners, since I talked about Full Metal Alchemist in homework last week and One Punch Man a bit before that, I had about 3 or 4 different people suggesting different animes I could watch.
Yes.
Look, guys, I'm sorry, no offense, but I don't want this to become the anime podcast. this is the Movie Mania podcast, not the Animania podcast. There's a good name for the podcast right there.
Animania. It's Animania. Mine, trademark. It's mine. No one can use it. Copyright.
Copyrighted. Yeah, so look, guys, I'm sure all that anime stuff's great, but I don't want it to become a thing where I have to keep watching anime every week.
Yeah,
because we try to keep it just focused on movies. But nothing against anime. I'm totally fine with anime. It's just kind of thing you're either
Anime is actually the worst. Anime is the worst. It's the worst thing possible. Just, you know, stoking that fire.
Trying to get some hate. Trigger. Fishing for more traitor comments. That's what you're doing. sorry, guys, but I'm not going to do any more anime stuff. Like, recommend movies and I'll watch them. Like, a couple of weeks ago, we talked about that Suicide Squad was rumored to have taken like certain elements from the animated Batman Assault on Arkham. So this week I was able to watch Batman Assault on Arkham because I hadn't seen it. And for those who haven't seen it, I'll give you a rough thumbnail sketch of like the plot without spoiling anything. It's basically a Suicide Squad is assembled, is sent to infiltrate into Arkham Asylum to get something that the Riddler has, like a thumb drive or something like that. But then Amanda Waller's doing all their shady different stuff of what's really going on and all this. And I'll save that for when you watch the movie. And of course, Batman's trying to get to Riddler's thing as well. So it's, it was quite interesting. And it's like, I could definitely see when I was watching it how several elements of that can just sort of translate right over into Suicide Squad. Because in this one, though, they had Rick Flagg was... I mean, in Suicide Squad, Rick Flagg is the main sort of leader of the group, and then you got Deadshot as Will Smith. In the animated one, Deadshot was the main leader guy, and in the comics, his character is white, so he's the white guy, but they did have a black character in the animated one called Black Spider, and I thought, oh, that's probably going to be what Will Smith in the movie is, because it was like they switched in the movie, but yeah. So yeah. I could definitely see like parallels like that, and I'm interested to see what they're going to do with the whole Harley Quinn Joker kind of mix up.
Yes.
And dynamic. Yeah, like which side is she really on? Is she you know, cuz a lot of people like maybe over the course of the movie she's going to sort of be like trying to free the Joker or something. Who knows what'll happen? But
well, my thing is like, is she gonna, you know, is she going to? Because in the animated movie, without giving too much away, I guess. In case you guys haven't seen it, it's a great movie. I think I really enjoyed it. From what I can remember, but like the way her story ends up playing out, it's like it's kind of a not necessarily a rehash, but kind of a retake on her original transformation, which, you know, the Joker will always be her Mr. J. She always loves the Joker. No matter what ends up happening, she always goes back to the Joker, you know? And so I think that'd be kind of a, like, say she escaped from the Joker, kind of like an episode of the animated series, when I think it's her and Catwoman go on an adventure or whatever. You know, sorry, keep going.
No, it's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Batman Assault on Arkham, it's really good. And yeah, if you have a chance to check it out before you go see Suicide Squad, yeah, I think you should. I think you'd really enjoy it.
Yeah, it'll catch you up to speed on what to probably expect. Who do you think is going to be the first person to blow up if they're going to do bombs in their head in the actual movie?
Yeah, because in Assault on Arkham, they put bombs in their neck, so if they don't do what they're told, their heads explode.
Yeah, classic Suicide Squad.
There's a big Russian guy called KG Beast instead of KGB, and he's like, "Oh, this is stupid," and he walks out and his head explodes.
Yeah,
so it shows everyone that these bombs are real. So yeah. I think actually, because in the big picture that they released of all the Suicide Squad, way over on the left, there's a guy called Slipknot, where his power
the rope
is
guy.
He's good with knots.
Yeah,
like he's dead.
He's a Boy Scout.
He's so dead.
He's a Boy Scout. He's a literal Boy Scout. I can do it. I can do a Slipknot. Yeah, yeah, I can buff that.
So yeah, he's probably first one whose head's gonna explode.
Watch it be Deadshot. Yeah, okay, well, I'm glad you enjoyed it. And yeah, guys, go check it out. It's really good. It'll catch up to speed on Suicide Squad, and it's kind of also set in the Arkham universe, so, you know, you'll catch a little Easter eggs to that. You know, there's a nice little Riddler cameo that works really well. Yeah. I saw Game of Thrones. I finished Game of Thrones.
Finally caught up. Yes.
Yeah. Spoilers. I don't want to go too deep into it because we can spend a whole hour and a half talking about it, and we probably will once this comes back on TV.
Yeah, time codes down in the description, whether you're watching on YouTube or listening on iTunes. In both cases, time codes down below you can use to jump spoilers. We'll have a bit to avoid spoilers in the Deadpool discussion too. So.
Yeah, full spoilers for Game of Thrones. That being said, segue, man.
Oh, that's what I forgot to do. I was supposed to put together a mixtape of all the times you say that being said. I knew I was forgetting something.
Memento style tattoo it on your, or like get a Sharpie and like write it on your mirror or something.
I'll do it next time. Yeah.
Don't worry, there'll be plenty of comments reminding you because I always read those and it's like, where's that compilation?
Yeah.
So Game of Thrones, I can't believe how good this show was. And I'm saying like it's over. It's not over. It's coming back in April, but I say was because it's never going to be as good as it has been. Because, you know, and like I said, I did some research and you are right. You know, they caught up with the books. You know, George R. R. Martin is currently writing the sixth book because it takes 8 years to write a book for that, I guess, which makes sense. It's like 1,000 pages long. And
you can see that now that they've overtaken the books and they're kind of putting in their own writing, it's not as good.
No, and I think they're going into the Walking Dead formula. And speaking of which, have you seen The Walking Dead? Did you watch The Walking Dead?
No, I haven't yet.
Okay, we'll talk about that next week then. Because it came back.
Yeah,
well, good for you. You know, they're going into the
so
Walking
taking
Dead.
Taking it's not very good. Okay.
Well, it's just my opinion. We have different opinions, Bandit. That's okay. It's all right. It's the internet. They're going to the Walking Dead formula of some episodes can easily be chopped out. And that sucks because Game of Thrones has always been such a tightly written show in which every episode something happens. Every time that episode finishes, you have to go and watch the next one. But with season 5, I'm like, yeah, I mean, not until like the last couple of episodes when things really go down. When those White Walkers get past that gate. And I had no idea what to expect when winter came, and
that was a great scene, wasn't it?
Yeah, like that is straight up Lord of the Rings, Battle of Helm's Deep, just horrible. Like they are trounced. How are they gonna win this? I'll tell you how. You get some dragons. Yeah, let's burn them all to the ground. I don't know, but
since I've seen it, but it's because his sword could block the White Walker's sword. Normally, the White Walker shatters the sword. But
Valyrian.
It was Valyrian steel, but that has... Was it Dragonstone mixed in with it or something? Was that what it was?
I don't know, but
there
I do know that
mixed in the blade,
Dragon Glass. Dragon Glass was basically obsidian.
That's it, Dragon Glass.
I looked like there was some Dragon Glass in it, but I know only two or three Dragon... or not Valyrian steel swords exist, two of which belong to, I think, Jaime Lannister, and then one belongs to Jon Snow, because originally it was just Jon Snow and Ned Stark's giant broadsword, but Tyrion, Tywin melted it down and gave him to Jaime Lannister. So it's interesting to know that, you know, the key to destroying these things are in two such divided halves of this world. But I can't tell. Okay, season four is probably my favorite season because that is really the season of the Lannisters. That is where we get to see the Lannisters pay for what they've done, and just in the worst ways possible. I mean, to be fair, Cersei doesn't get hers until season five of episode 10. And by the
way,
oh, man. Yes. I was never like, you think when Joffrey died, I was smiling and clapping. Man, whenever Xerxes walking down in the buff, walking down these steps, people are flinging turds at her. People are peeing on her, spitting her in the face. I'm just like, yeah, shame. I was so pumped to just see it. And it's crazy, like, how a TV show can get you so pumped up for just watching someone just get horrifically treated. Like, she is getting treated like total garbage, but good for her. She's sitting in the prison crying. I'm like, no sympathy. And she's like, he's like, yeah, you could go back to the castle after your atonement. I'm like, yeah, after the atonement. And they cut her hair, her head's bleeding and whatnot. I'm just like, yeah, shame, die, suffer. I was so happy.
You know, she's so gonna get them back though. Those guys are all dead.
I'm not looking forward to it, but what'd you say? Yeah, but they're all gonna pay.
They might not know, because they might not now though, because Tywin was kind of like, he was kind of the one that was really running everything, wasn't he? Because Joffrey wasn't doing anything. So, everyone else was just sort of lame. He was the one who was really holding it all together. Now there's no real strong leadership for the Lannisters. I mean, there's his brother is there, but he doesn't seem to be quite the same. So who knows? Maybe they won't get revenge on those Sparrow guys or whatever they are.
I mean, look, I don't like anybody in King's Landing right about now, except maybe Jaime. But Jaime's not in King's Landing right now, is he?
Yeah.
He's over on the
sassy Latino land.
Yeah, he's in Dorne. Which, when that guy went out the way he did, that was tough to watch. But the Lannisters got what they deserved. The way Tyrion took out Tywin on the toilets, I was so happy. I was so happy. Like,
remember last week when we were talking about the Red Wedding, and we were saying how in the books, if you kill someone at the wedding, you're like cursed by the gods.
Yeah.
And I said, well, because the Lannisters, if they were cursed from that point on, like each one of the Lannisters has something horrible happen to them in the future. And you see, like, now it pretty much has, except maybe Jaime or Tyrion.
Yeah, so I'm a little nervous for Jaime. Well, Tyrion's been through the rough.
Yeah,
his whole life has been pretty bad. And like when he's in the trial and they pull out Shay and she just like reveals like the whole time she was just playing with them, and he's just like, you know what? I'll let the gods do my work. I demand a trial by combat. I've watched that scene so many times because everyone's different reaction is perfect. But the Latino guy that ends up fighting for him, I feel like his reaction is the audience's reaction, because like he sits up in his chair, puts his hand on his chin, like, okay, all right. That's, I feel like that was my reaction. I was like, yeah, what's next? Everyone's so mad. Tywin looks so upset, and Tyrion's just like, yeah, I got you now. And yeah, it's a. Man, that's a great show. I'm so happy.
Now we got Zombie Mountain.
Yeah. Oh, boy. And then Jon Snow.
That weird Frankenstein doctor guy.
We got Frankenstein the Mountain. Yeah. I don't know what that is, but I'm not looking forward to whatever he's going to do. Oh, speaking of the mountain, when the Hound died, that was also very sad.
Yeah.
That depressed me.
I like to believe he's not dead. I like to believe he's still alive.
Nah. If he is,
I'm... You know what I thought? Like... You know what I thought would be great is, because remember how he meets up with the Brotherhood Without Banners, those kind of Robin Hood thief guys, and he kills that dude, and then he gets resurrected by the fire god, that guy. I thought, well, they're wandering around the forest. I thought, wouldn't it be funny if like he dies, if the Hound dies, and then those guys bring the Hound back to life in the same way. So then you've got a guy who's afraid of fire being resurrected by the fire god.
Yeah, speaking of the
I would
fire
love
god,
that. That'd be great.
How nervous did you get when the red chick asked Jon Snow if he was a virgin? Because I did. I was freaking out. When he's like, when she's like, are you a virgin? And he's like, no. And, he's, and she's like, good. I was like, yeah, yeah, yeah. Stay away from my Jon.
Yeah, she wants that king blood. Hey guys, it's Bandit, just interrupting here. The Skype dropped out at this point, and it took us like 20 minutes to try and get it back again. So when we did get it back, we thought we'll just jump straight into Deadpool and cover it while we still could. Fortunately, though, it didn't drop out for the rest of the podcast. So enjoy. Thank God we finally got the Skype back.
Yeah. Let's hear. Tell you what, Bandit. Tell you what. Just in case the Skype call went to drop out again, let's just jump right in the Deadpool here.
Let's do that.
And now, our feature presentation.
Thank God we finally got the Skype back.
Yeah. Let's hear. Tell you what, Bandit. Tell you what. Just in case the Skype call went to drop out again, let's just jump right in the Deadpool here.
Let's do that.
Okay. All right. So, Bandit, why don't you go first? Give me your thoughts on Deadpool.
Well, my overall thoughts for Deadpool were I really loved it. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was really fantastic. And while we're in the non-spoiler section, because, again, time code's down below. If you guys, when we get to the spoiler stuff, if you haven't seen it, you'll see the time codes. You can just skip forward to listener questions. But while we're in the non-spoiler section, for those who are thinking, like, we know Deadpool's a little bit naughty. Is it appropriate for kids, though? Because the filmmakers actually kind of said it is. Which
and
they
I
might be trying
agree,
to punk
and I
everyone.
Kind of agree with them. I kind of agree with them because, and here's my thing. You know, growing up, you know, I'm 16 years old, so maybe this comes from a little biased perspective. But, you know, growing up, I was never one to be super shielded from the quote unquote adult kind of stuff. You know, I watched Family Guy, I watched some of The Simpsons. You know, I watched, you know, the cartoons that most parents wouldn't let their kids watch. I went and saw R-rated movies with my parents all the time. Like, I would go see a kid's movie, and then I would just walk into, because this is before they had allocated seating in most theaters. And so I would just walk into the theater with my parents watching some R-rated movie, and I'd just sit down and watch it with them. You know, I told you my first R-rated movie alone was Wolf of Wall Street. You know, growing up, and because I guess I was such a big fan of movies, I never discriminated against what counts as an R rating or a PG-13. It's just whatever that is in the movie constitutes that rating. Sure. But I understand why they're there, because kids are very impressionable. But my thing at this point in society, I don't mean to get too political here, but especially like by the time I was in sixth grade, I knew pretty much all about the birds and the bees without ever talking to my parents.
Yeah.
So
with the existence of the internet kind of means
exactly
that whatever you're trying to shield kids from with like movie ratings, they've probably seen much worse on the internet.
Exactly.
Already, anyway.
And I'm not just talking about pornographic material. I'm talking about like just YouTube comments, references and videos they can easily go and look up. Yeah. They listen to podcasts. They have friends who talk dirty.
Yeah.
It happens. Well, so unless you're like an Amish kid, you're, you know.
Well, I found this, this website that gives you a complete rundown of exactly how many swears there are in Deadpool and all the different swear words. So I thought I'd read it out for any people here are thinking about taking their nephews or something like that. Okay, there's 84 F-bombs, 3 obscene hand gestures, 21 sexual references, 34 scantological terms. I don't know what that even means.
Like saying like tits or something? Sorry, pardon my French. Like, I guess like that.
8 mild obscenities, brackets, calling someone weird, stupid, idiot, tool, douchebag. And there is... yeah, that was it. So there you go. 81 F-bombs, 3 obscene hand gestures, 21 sexual references, 34 scatological terms, and 8 mild obscenities. So anyone out there can make up their own mind as to what age bracket they want to take to that.
Yeah, honestly,
I loved it. I loved it.
I would take a 10-year-old girl to go see this, especially if she likes superheroes. I think she would enjoy it. I take a little girl to see it. She'll like it. I wouldn't take a little boy to go see it. Not because it's inappropriate, but because they get bored. Because... you know
what? Get out of here!
Just because like the action—it's not that the action is sparse. It's that first of all, they won't get the jokes that they're saying, because most of the jokes are either references or crude jokes. They won't get like a joke about a guy, you know, looking like he could lead kids into a windowless van. A kid, which is a great joke, but a kid, teenagers will understand that.
I mean, again,
yeah, but I'm saying, like, you take, like, this, like, you can take, I think you can take a little girl to, because little girls tend to be a bit more mature in terms of behavior at that age. But if you take a little boy, this, he's going to get bored. He's going to want to get all rowdy. He's going to want to stand up and walk around, because every time that, you know, they go to a strip club or they, or a sex scene happens or the romance stuff happens, they're going to be bored out of their minds.
Okay.
And the action is few and far between.
There's a quote from Trey, everyone.
Oh,
teenage
boy.
Boys will be bored watching Deadpool.
That's not what I said. That's not at all what I said. That's not at all what I said. I said young boys. I'm not talking about teenage boys. I'm a teenage boy. I wasn't bored. Well, I was, but
teenage boy. Oh, well, whatever.
No, I mean, like say, like you have a 10-year-old boy and a 10-year-old girl. Yeah. I would take the 10-year-old girl to go see it because she would have a nice time, especially if she likes superheroes. But if you take the 10-year-old boy, he's going to be bored out of his mind because that's a fifth grader or whatever. He's not going to like most of this movie just because of its. You see what I'm trying to get at here?
Yeah, yeah.
There's a lack of action in certain aspects.
Well, there's also a ton of 90s references because Deadpool was created in the 90s. And also, with its rating, I guess they're assuming the age group that will be allowed to go in there will have lived through the 90s, so they'll understand a lot of it. I did.
I understood all the references. Bits and pieces, which is fine, I guess. Have you even given your thoughts on the movie yet? I don't even...
Yeah, I think it was really great. I think it was really great. The story was, the plot was very, very generic. But it works because you've got Deadpool's just being Deadpool. He's not, so you kind of got this character who's not following the rules in the framework of what is a standard superhero movie. It's basically like Wolverine Origins, only with less twists and turns in it. But
yeah,
Deadpool is what makes the movie, not really the story. That was my general overview of it. What do you think of it?
And that's really my general problem. See, the movie, and I will describe it in three words, and it's good, not great. Which I hate to say because I was really looking forward to this movie. I've been excited for it for months, maybe years, maybe. I remember ever since that test footage release, I'm like, oh yeah, just make that the Deadpool movie. And for a certain aspect of it, they did. It's ultimately when they get to the... You know, and I saw it with my friend Christian. When we got out of it, we said, I turned to him and I said, you know, whenever there was comedy, the comedy for like 80% of the jokes landed, all the action was great. It's the drama that fails for me really poorly. I was not a fan of anything else. Of like every time they had to get serious for the sake of it being a movie, I felt like they dropped the ball. And that's where it really killed it for me because, which sucks because, you know, you're out of the movie and then a joke pulls you back in, so you're ready to be back into the movie, and then you get pulled out again because you're not invested in what's happening on screen because you're bored. Like, that's how I looked at it, and I guess I should tell the story of how I was able to see it in the first place. I was so nervous because, like, movie theaters are really trying to crack down on making sure that underage kids do not go and see R-rated movies for some odd reason, which is stupid. Like we were trying to time it right, because, you know, the way my movie theater is set up is that, you know, you'll have right next to the ticket kiosk where you buy your tickets either inside or outside, they'll have little, you know, the little ropes that say, you know, hey, hand me your ticket so you can walk into the theater. But after a certain hour, they instead of putting the tickets there, you know, you give the person your ticket right in front of where the auditoriums are, like right down the hallways. And so I'm like, okay, we have to try to get there in time so that, you know, we don't have to worry about, because, you know, you hand somebody a ticket and they'll be like, oh, hi, are you 18? When I see your ID, I'm like, come on, man, I already got my bloody ticket. And so we got into the auditorium, we walked past the people, we made it in, and I'm walking, and who do I see? I see a 60-year-old attendee who looks like a general manager standing right inside the auditorium. And it's like, have you seen the movie Argo?
Oh yeah.
You remember like in Argo when like they're trying to get to the on the plane,
yeah,
and the people keep stopping. I'm like, I can't tell. I was shaking in my seat, just walking by, because not only was it me and my friend Christian, but it was Christian's little sister who's like 12, and so I'm just like, oh god, please don't. So
probably
I'm
not
just
a good,
like,
move of taking her if you're trying to sneak in. I'm just saying.
Well, that's what I told Christian. I'm like, Christian, this is not a good idea. Because his dad had already pulled off at that point. I'm like, this is not a good idea. I'm not watching Dune 2. And he said, and I told him, I'm like, mom, afternoon, sir. He's like, afternoon, sir. And I walked in. I was just like, whew, and then I sat down in my seat and I was just like, no one move, no one go to the restroom, I'm not coming to get you. So I was, oh man, that was, it was nerve-wracking, but I got in there and I watched it, and I'm glad I watched it. But man, what,
that is dedication to this podcast, really.
Yeah,
really.
You're telling me, man.
See, I just walk up and they're like, hey, grandpa, go in there. And I'm like, shut up.
Yeah, they're like, you know? They're like, right this way. Don't worry. We'll help you cross the street. Come on, right this way. So they all wearing Boy Scout uniforms. No, but in terms of the actual movie,
yeah.
I think Ryan Reynolds is great. Marina Baccarin is wonderful. Like, I think she, for the first two thirds, is really good. I think TJ Miller steals the show for me. Every time he's on screen, I was just having the time of my life.
Yeah.
I really liked Ed Skrein as the villain, the British guy. Yeah. I really like the film's irreverent
sense. I love how in the opening credits it actually called him the evil British guy.
that's kind of a spoiler, but yes, I also very much enjoyed that. Again, going to the opening credits, I love the movie's sense of humor. I love how right away you're understanding, like, yeah, they're able to give you in right away exactly what this movie is, and without giving too much away, because as this is a comedy, giving away the jokes would kind of be a spoiler, so I'm trying to be careful. Because,
well, actually, yeah, like, because there's a lot of jokes I liked, but let's not say it, because those are the best parts of the movie. Well, we'll
exactly
save them for the spoilers.
Like, it's like knowing the punchline before you're hearing the setup, you know?
Yeah,
like,
but so far, like, it's doing really well financially so far. And generally, the fan reaction is people love it. The critics, not so much.
It's got like an 84% on Rotten Tomatoes.
I haven't checked that, but just from what I've heard so far of some of the more, not like the YouTube reviewers, but more like the critic, you know, like the old men sort of thing.
Okay.
A lot of them are making points, and I suppose it's a valid point, where they're saying it's kind of like the whole thing of Deadpool is like he's subversive, he breaks the fourth wall, and he's the only one who's aware he's in a comic book, or in this case, in a movie, and he makes jokes about stuff that, you know, the actors in the movie have done before. And like, but some of the critics, I'm doing air quotes, say that it's kind of like corporate subversiveness. It's kind of like manufactured anarchy, and I think that's kind of a fair point.
My
phone's going off. My cousin, he just messaged me. He's like, hey, you should check out Deadpool, it's really cool. And I'm like,
I felt like a family tragedy just happened. I'm like, man, we cannot get this podcast done today. I got really nervous. I'm like, oh man. No, but
special shout out to my cousin, whose name I'm not going to say on the podcast because you might not want me to reveal your name. So
fair enough. I'll say my friend's name was Christian. Fair enough. I think they're maybe giving, not necessarily giving Fox too much credit, but I think they're thinking maybe a little too much into this. This movie's not meant for deep analysis. That being said, it's spent an hour deeply analyzing this movie. But manufactured anarchy seems a little.
Yeah, I get what they're trying to say, but it's like, yeah, it's trying to be subversive, but it kind of wasn't, because the plot was just so basic by the book, wasn't it?
Well, I feel like I guess what they're trying to say is they were trying to make fun of the comic book genre. And in a way, I don't feel like they succeeded there, but they succeeded more in poking fun at the franchise itself, as more of the character and Fox Studios itself, than just the whole comic book genre in its entirety. Like we were saying last week, it would have been great if we had a joke of like Deadpool walks past a door and he says, that's for the sequel. That would have been that's a great joke to talk about franchise building and all that.
Yeah.
But they did have a great joke that I don't want to give away until the spoilers. I'm gonna write it down about the X-Men itself and the mansion.
It was fantastic. But look, I agree with you. Like, I wanted them to go more into that kind of stuff. Like, I wanted to see Deadpool trolling the Fantastic Four.
Yeah, oh,
that'd
my
be
God.
Amazing. How funny would that be?
I wanted Deadpool to break down the script, because that's how the video game opens. And I said this last week as well. It's like the video game opens with Deadpool getting a call from the game studio, shooting the director, blowing up the game studio, breaking down the script, adding his own notes to it. Yeah. And I mean, I guess you can't really do that for a mainstream audience. I guess I feel like this is as far Fox would let them push it, in terms of breaking the fourth wall. And there's the end credits scene is just wonderful. Yeah. Did you say
again? Did you get that? Because that's another 90s
yes.
reference.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Like, was that reference?
Well, basically, like, again, we won't give any spoilers, but in the end credits scene, Deadpool literally tells you the character that's going to be in the next one. And it's all over the internet, so it's not a spoiler, but it's Cable. And on Twitter, the guy called Sherman Stephen Lang, who was the bad guy in Avatar, he's actually kind of campaigning for the role of Cable. And
I want Liam Neeson to have it. I want to give it to Liam Neeson.
Yeah, Liam Neeson would be good too.
He'd be a great Cable. But you know, he maybe can't do the action as well, but he'd be great. He's a good actor. Sorry.
Yeah. But Cable in the comics, he's like got a metal arm, and I don't know a huge amount about him, but Deadpool mentions there's like time travel and all that, and I thought, could you imagine how much fun Deadpool could have making fun of all the time travel stuff?
Oh my god.
He would have, there's so much funny stuff you could do with that.
Like, he could easily just, well, I don't know how far there, because like what we're saying is basically, is basically the idea we had last week and what Deadpool could do with this comic book genre. And after watching the movie, they really, I don't want to say they play it safe because this isn't a safe movie, but they more or less...
They kind of do though, don't they? In a weird way.
Well, and the fact that they went as far as I think Fox would, but I think hopefully now that they showed that they can make $135 million in 3 days for an R-rated comic book movie, hopefully that shows that Fox can put a lot more faith than they already had in these guys, and they can really let Deadpool go.
Insanity next time.
Think that's what I want to see, and I feel like that's where the movie, that's why I like the movie's boring, because it's not 100% boring. Like, it's still a good movie, but it's just like, it didn't hit me the way it hit everybody else. I don't see what everyone else is talking about, because the action's great, the comedy's great, but everything else in between that, it's like having really great lettuce and tomato on a sandwich that just has bland bread and bland meat. And you're just like, yeah, it's, the lettuce was good, but the main meat of the movie itself didn't, the main plot of the movie didn't really hold up for me, and that, it bored me.
I know, like, I hear what you're saying, and I do agree with you, but I think they did take it as far as they could have taken it in the first shot. In the next one, they can go, like, you know, fourth wall breaking, they could have a bit where someone shoots at him, and he dodges the bullet by literally jumping through the screen and landing in the cinema amongst the crowd. Like in Last Action Hero, they could have him do that. Like, he sidesteps out of the screen and dodges, like, a bullet, and he's like, oh, hi, and someone's popcorn jumps back in. Like, stuff like that.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I say he's watching Game of Thrones.
Or, like, with the time travel. We need to reset the plot. I mean, the timeline. We need to retcon the timeline. I mean, fix the timeline.
Yeah, there's a great line about time travel and what it does to the universe. You know, there's a great, I don't want to give it away, but there's a great joke involving Patrick Stewart and Ian McKellen, or Patrick Stewart and James McAvoy that's just one of the best lines of the movie. How cool would it be, like Deadpool's watching TV and like he's watching Game of Thrones or something, and he like walks into the TV and just like, no, no. Like, he fixes everything. It's like he picks up Tyrion Lannister and puts him on the Iron Throne. You know, he's like, that's better. He's like, that's better.
Yeah.
Or
I'd like, if he's gonna do time travel, he could have a bit where he's like got like the Back to the Future like picture of a guy in the future. And, like, he shoots him in the foot, and then the picture changes, and he's got, like, a wooden leg. He's like, oh, cool. Shoots him in the hand, and then he loses a head in the picture. I can see Deadpool having fun with stuff like that, being like, oh, let's see what happens if I do this.
And that's the thing, too. Like, all the Deadpool stuff works really great. That's why I say that the best scene of the movie is in the first and last 10 minutes. And that's when the movie really shines, because that's when they let Deadpool just straight up be Deadpool. Like, you know, when he's killing people, he's just waltzing his way around, just taking people out, cutting hands off, you know, whether it be his own or other people's. It's, you know, everything with Colossus and Negasonic Teenage Warhead was really good, you know. And that's why I'm saying, like, I don't hate this movie. People are going to think, oh, Trey didn't like the movie. No, I like the movie. I just think that it could have been a lot better than what they promised us in that marketing campaign. Mm. Yeah, 8 out of 10. Or no, not 8 out of 7.5 out of 10. Sorry, yeah.
Okay, so there you go. You want to jump into spoilers?
Yeah, let's jump in. Well, what would you give out of 10, Bandits?
Oh, yeah,
since got you here.
I always forget to rate it. It's okay. I'd probably give it like an 8 out of 10.
Okay.
And I think it was, like I said, I think it was as good as it could have been, and as far as they could have pushed it. Sure, they could have gone further, but realistically, it was, with the odds stacked against them of this movie even getting made, I think we couldn't have hoped for a better Deadpool, realistically, at this time. And looking forward to the sequel.
And they joke about how the movie barely got made, and it's they handled the character of Deadpool with some serious justice, and it's very important. Go out and see the movie if you haven't seen it. You're going to enjoy it, you know, whether or not you're just a comic movie fan. You know, you may not love like the rest of the world does, but you'll have some enjoyment in it, and, you know, you'll laugh a lot.
Sure.
Yeah, so go out and see it. Okay.
So, full spoilers. Three, two, one.
Valamagulis. Sorry.
Valamagulis. There we go. Now, tell me if this was the same in your cinema, but I found, like, in my cinema, like, especially with some of the more dirty jokes, the laughter would kind of come in waves, because it would be like, he'd make the joke and then people would laugh. And then a few seconds later, more people would be like, what is he? Oh, I get it. And then they'd laugh. So
it would kind of come in waves. They would make like a, like, and I think that shows how clever the movie can be sometimes. Like, you know, there'd be some less subtle ones where they'd be like, you know, whose balls did I have to fondle to get this movie made? I'll give you a hint. It rhymes with Wolverine. And like, everyone would just like erupt laughing. Yeah. Or then, you know, like, and then he'll be like,
I think the most obvious part of that sort of laugh, waves of laughter for me, was the bit where his hand's growing back because he cut off his hand. It's like,
Oh my God, that was so lovely.
Because I bet it feels enormous with his hand. And, like, people laughed, but then other people, like, what is he? Oh, right. And then
that was so...
What is he referring to? Oh! So we cover these waves. I thought that was great.
Yeah, it was... And I think it's weird because the my audience that I watched it with, I'm not sure if they enjoyed it as much as a lot of people. I know some people were dying. Like, people were clapping and like, some people were really enjoying it. But there were other people, like, I felt like, say we're looking at the screen, the right corner of the theater was just loving it. But like the whole like left side was just like, yeah, you know, the occasional chuckle, the occasional laugh, which is weird because I was dying pretty much during all the jokes. Like a lot of the, I don't usually say this, but don't swallow. All those jokes just killed me. Like, it, like at the end, it's like pull out shot. And that's all you'll be pulling out tonight. And I'm just like, wow. Wow. That's rough.
Hey guys, it's Bandit. I'm interrupting again. Now that we're officially in the spoilers, I can tell you something that I forgot to mention in the podcast, which is the end credit scene at the end of the movie. I actually recorded it on my phone. So now that we're in the full spoiler section, in case you did see the movie but you didn't stay to see the end credit scene at the end, I'm going to play the audio here. I can't play the visuals on YouTube because I'll get hit by copyright, but hopefully the audio just alone should get past. So, yep, here's the end credit scene in case you missed it.
You're still here. It's over. Go home. Oh, you're expecting a teaser for Deadpool 2. Well, we don't have that kind of money. You expecting Sam Jackson to show up with an eye patch and a saucy little leather number? Go. Oh, but I can tell you one thing, and it's a bit of a secret. For the sequel, we're going to have Cable. Amazing character, bionic arm, time travel. We have no idea who we're going to cast yet, but it could be anybody. Just need a big guy with a flat top. It could be Mel Gibson, Dolph Lundgren, Keira Knightley. She's got Revenge, who knows? Anyway, big secret. Shh. Oh, and don't leave your garbage all lying around. It's a total dick move. Go.
I like the bits where, like at the beginning of the movie where it pauses and he's like, but wait a minute, you're saying, my boyfriend says it's a superhero movie.
Yeah.
He just impaled that guy on a sword.
Yeah, and like
it's
the way he said it,
a love
like,
story. Then later
just
on,
turn that guy into a kebab. I'm like, because like I remember I could hear somebody in the background be like, yeah, that's what he said. Like you could tell like girlfriends were being dragged to me like, wait, my boyfriend said this was a superhero movie because all the guys know what this is. But like, oh, that's a good joke. That's a good way to start the movie. It's great if I hadn't.
Yeah.
And you think, oh, I've seen this scene.
But then later on when it changes, he's like, did I say love story? I meant horror movie.
Yeah.
Because it really has this vicious sort of change.
Yeah, visceral really kind of transformation sequence when we see his skin transform. And it's actually quite brutal. Like body horror shocking. I'm like, wow, they got some legit terror out of me. That's a good job. Mm. You know, it's a shame if, you know, the love story. And that's, I think, with Vanessa, that character Vanessa, it's great that we live in an age now where they don't have to acknowledge that a strong female character is a female. And I love it because I'm so sick of movies being like, oh, but you're a woman. And then just like beating the man. And it's like, oh, well, I guess you're a strong woman. No. None of that anymore. Like, even in Game of Thrones, you have female characters who use their, you know, their sexuality or just are straight up, you know, bamps. You know, they're really awesome people. And with Vanessa, at first, like, man, she's just as twisted and messed up as Wade is. You know, these two are perfect for each other, and she has a lot of charisma. She has a lot of charm to her. She's wonderful. She's great to watch. Marita Baccarin's killing it. And then come the third act, as Doug Walker would say, she kind of goes Christopher Nolan, and where she just kind of like gets kind of a dead-eyed look in her. I feel like she lost all her charm. I feel like everything about – yeah, I didn't get anything from her after once, you know, they get reunited, which I guess is kind of the character because she's been away with him from him like for so long. But even after she accepts him back into, you know, her life, I'm like, I can't, there's nothing here for me right now. I'm not into this. I don't know. Something about it just lost me in that third act. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I actually like, I didn't have a problem with her. I like that actress. I like the character. I had no idea she's actually a character that's going to be called Copycat or something in the future.
Yes.
Like,
yeah, I was wondering if we're going to do that in this one, yeah.
Yeah, well, I like, there was nothing in the movie to give me a clue of that just later on, you know, when I saw some of the YouTube videos, I was like, oh, she's going to be somebody. I figured that the guy, when he's in the torture place, there's like one scene where he's talking to the guy who's across from him and they're kind of friends and he sees him right before the whole place burns down. And with that guy, I'm like, well, he's probably going to be somebody later, or he's going to come back in the next movie. And apparently he'll be a character called Worm, whoever that is.
Whoever that is. Oh, our nerd cred is slowly dropping. How could you not know who this one obscure character is? Worst
people
ever.
I'm a DC fan. I'm not...
Yeah, there you go. And the truth comes out.
Hey, look, I'm a DC fan, not a Marvel fan.
Look, I'm a fan of good movies. That's my defense.
That joke that you referenced in the first one where he's like, Colossus, who I love, by the way, that he's actually finally so Russian, brilliant. Finally done right. And he's like, I am taking you to the professor. And he's like, which one? This timeline
is like
so confusing.
McAvoy or Stewart. He's like, that whole time travel thing just really messed your whole plot up. It's like, man, I clapped. I was like, bravo. It's like, bravo, you guys. I don't know if that was, I don't know if that was improv or not, but man, that, so many, it's jokes like that that make me mad that the rest of the plot is just snoozeville. Yeah. But
well, you know, I heard that X-Men Apocalypse is going to be Bryan Singer's last X-Men movie.
Yay! Well, for now.
And guess what he's doing? He's sending them back into the black leather. Oh.
Yeah. And it was so refreshing to see Negasonic Teenage Warhead in
actual color.
In the X-Men suits, like first class.
This is why Bryan Singer sucks, and we don't need him anymore. Because he's stuck in the 90s and not in
the
cool Deadpool kind of way.
That's not the only reason he sucks. It's not the only reason he sucks. Though I swear to God, if he puts it.
That's a Deadpool style joke there. Yeah.
Oh, no, I wasn't trying.
I
was referring to, you know, his lack of characterization and his muting of colors and shots.
Oh, I thought you were referring
His allegations? No, thank you. No, thank you.
I thought you were referring to his social life. Anyway.
Besides, it's legal now. Anyways. Well, not rape, but being gay is legal now. So
yeah, I got... okay, what is it here? I got... Oh, there's... Yeah, I like the bit where he and Veronica, or Copycat, whatever her name is, when they're having that whole... When they first meet and they're having that conversation about who's got the more tragic backstory. Which is actually taken directly from a Monty Python skit, where there's a bunch of guys talking about how they used to be poor and they're all trying to like one up each other about who had it harder as a poor. Like, it was like, we used to live in like one room with a big hole in the roof. You were lucky to have a room. We used to live in a hole in the ground with a tarp over it. You were lucky to have a tarp. It's like
we used to have to drink rainwater. Well, you were lucky you had a tongue. Yeah, it's like and it just gets worse and worse.
Our dad would thrash us to sleep with his belt. Luxury.
He's like, he's like, you're lucky you had a belt. We didn't have pants. Yeah. Yeah, and that whole tragic backstory thing is, I can't necessarily repeat a lot of the quotes that are said in the movie, but I think that I thought, whoops, never mind. Thought over, never mind, keep going through your notes.
The only part I was kind of bored was during the bit that you mentioned in our non-spoiler section where, yeah, when they have the flashback and he just finds out he's got cancer and they're doing the whole romance bit, that dragged on a bit. I was like, I took out my phone, I wrote down, I was like, yeah, this is getting kind of boring, can you move it along? Then I was like, oh, yeah, they moved along, great.
I liked how they broke up the main action sequence, because it pretty much is all one action sequence.
Yeah.
But they break it up, they pull Batman Begins, kind of, you know, where they break it up.
Yeah, they do pull a Batman Begins.
Yeah, where they break it up, you know, through the flashbacks, which is a very clever way to do your flashbacks and catch yourself up to speed, and now we're in the third act, let's get to the final action sequence. Mm. And, you know,
could
that
you
whole
imagine
thing...
if they had done it linear? It would have been so boring.
Yes, absolutely. But I think that's a credit to quote the movie, The True Heroes here, which is a great line. It's like written by the True Heroes here, when talking about the film's writers, and yeah, and then like directed by an overpaid studio head or whatever.
A hot chick, a pointless
a hot
cameo.
Chick. A pointless gratuitous cameo, yeah. Right, yeah. A CGI character, an angsty teen, and I'm like, wow. They,
overpaid director. Honestly,
overpaid director, yeah. What's it like, Ryan Reynolds is like God's gift to man or something like that. It's like, yeah.
Did you like the fourth wall break inside a fourth wall break equals 16
yes.
walls?
Yeah, he's like, that's like 16 walls. I'm like,
I love that.
I'm not sure that's how the math works, but then again, I'm not very good at math. And since we can talk about the end credits scene now, I loved the Ferris Bueller. I think Ferris Bueller was the 80s, right? It was like 86
oh, yeah,
or something.
It was the 80s, yeah.
Yeah, so and like the moment it was over, I turned to Christian's sister and I said, "Do you get that?" And she's just like, "No." I'm like, "It's Ferris Bueller."
Well,
and I'm like, "Christian,
13, there's no way she'd know that."
I'm like, "Well, look, I saw Ferris Bueller when I was 10 years old." Then again, I love movies. I turned to Christian and I said, "Christian, do you get it?" And he's like, "No." I'm like, it's Ferris Bueller. He's like, yeah, I never saw it. I'm like, yeah, I know. You know, it's like
people who have seen Ferris Bueller don't know there's that end credit scene.
Really?
Nobody did end credit scenes in the 80s. That was amazing.
But I mean, like, at this point, it's been out for 30 years. Like, it's, I feel like at this point, the whole world knows that Ferris Bueller has that end credit scene. Yeah. You're still here?
But that
movie's
was probably
over?
The first end credit scene. That's probably why Deadpool did it like that.
Yeah, that because the first end credit scene is basically just him breaking the fourth wall. I love when he's just like, yeah, what are you expecting, Sam Jackson with an eye patch? No. It's over. Goodbye. Though we will have Cable. Chica-chica. Yeah. Yeah, that was a great end credit scene. I applauded the movie after that.
I did really like Megasonic Teenage Warhead as well. I think
yes,
the,
I did too.
The interaction between like her and Deadpool was really good.
Oh my god, when he opens the door,
like she
Ripley.
Could own him a couple of times, but then eat her a couple of times. And yeah.
Ripley from Alien 3, how are you doing? I'm like, wow.
And like, it cuts she's her, like, you are stressed. So old. And he goes, ah, yeah. I'm laughing on the outside, but hurting on the inside.
Yeah. He's like, probably the best line of the movie. He's like, huh, it's just you, huh? It's kind of like the studio could only afford two X-Men. That's the best. I was in tears. That was the best line of the, everyone lost their mind at that joke.
Great.
That was so wonderful. Like, wow, it's kind of empty in here. It's kind of like the studio could only afford two X-Men. That was, oh my god, I was so
I
happy. That's what I was, I'm like, that's what I'm talking about. That's Deadpool joke. That's, man, that's
the only, I think the only joke reference like that I didn't like, because I was waiting for them to have a bit where they say about sewing his mouth shut. Because I thought, definitely they're going to do that. And of course they did. But it's like when Ajax, the villain, is like, shut up or I'll sew your mouth shut. And he's like, oh, that's not a good idea. I thought it would have been better if like Deadpool said something like, oh, so that was your idea. That figures.
Oh, that would be great.
Or something like that, you know.
You're the guy that did that. It's like, or it's like, you know, maybe sew your mouth shut. It's like, oh, the fans won't like that. You know, it's like, he looks at the camera and he's like,
yeah,
try him.
Something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah. He looks at the camera and it's like, yeah, try me. You know, and I think the best thing about the marketing is that they got some of the best jokes out of the way. You know, or some of the they
well,
got
they
redubbed not the
some
best
of them
jokes
for the movie because
yeah,
of the
oh,
mask,
not,
you can
not,
just
yeah.
dove in new lines.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like they didn't give away the best jokes. They got yeah. they yeah, they save the best jokes for the movie. And even some, like you said, some lines were redubbed. Like, instead of just a random person thinking that they're like, your boyfriend said it was a superhero movie, it's like, yeah, little touches like that, you know, with less angry Rosie O'Donnell, which was wonderful. Yeah. I do know who Rosie O'Donnell is. Yeah, so good
what,
for me.
What did you think of the villain? Did you think the villain was a bit weak?
No,
I think he was serviceable.
I think he's one of the best comic villains we've seen in a, and that's not saying much considering the fact that, you know, I guess maybe if you look at the TV stuff, then we've gotten some good comic villains, but in terms of like the movie villains, I can look to maybe Ultron, of course, but besides that, it's pretty much been genericville for the last couple of years, so it's nice to see a villain that actually has some personality to him, and is, you know, he's a British evil guy, which it allows him to be douchey and be kind of, you know, he's snarky, he's conniving, he's rude, but, you know, he's clearly able to, he has charisma to him, and he's fun to watch. Unlike Ronan, where I'm just bored, or Malekith, when no one remembers you, and that's just the editor's fault, or what's his name, Yellow Jacket, where I don't care, or whatever the heck Dr. Doom was, man. So, you know,
I did find it interesting with Ajax, though, because it's like, because apparently in the comics,
he
made
himself after a soap, awesome, sorry.
But because in the comics, apparently he's like his arch nemesis. But I actually kind of liked it in this, that even though he's done all this horrible stuff to Deadpool, and Deadpool does want to get him back, he's not really like an arch nemesis. I actually kind of like that for some weird reason. I don't know why. But it's like Deadpool, he wants to get him back, but he's not like so consumed with revenge, you know? No. So like, he's just like, yeah, I'm going to kill you, man.
I love what he's like, what's my name? He's like, oh, I'm gonna spell it out for you. I love that. I'm gonna spell it out for you. And then at the end, it's like, what's your name? It's like, who cares? And he's about to shoot him. And then that would have been such a cool moment though if Colossus hadn't jumped in and did a Captain America comic book style speech.
Yeah.
Where they just get his drum down and just like, you know, bah.
But everybody knew he was gonna shoot him. But
oh, absolutely, absolutely.
I thought it would
have
been funnier if like Colossus finishes his big speech. And then it cuts to like Deadpool, and he's like leaning against something, and he's just holding the guy's decapitated head.
Yes.
He's like, sorry, what? I wasn't listening.
So are you saying something? Yeah. Or he's like taking a selfie with the shot face.
He's holding the head next to his, and he's taking a selfie. He's like, huh? What?
Were you saying something? Yeah,
let's edit that in. That would have been funny.
Yeah, that's okay. It was still a nice little joke, actually, and I like how you're Colossus.
They probably wouldn't do that because there'd be too much like ISIS. But yeah,
this movie's
not get political.
This movie's not worried about being politically correct. I'll tell you what: the moment you have Stan Lee being like a stripper announcer, give it up for Chastity.
Oh,
which
that was great too. I love that.
I completely forgot he was in this because I remember they showed him briefly in the Comic-Con trailer that got leaked, which I don't think they ever released.
I didn't think he would be in it. But he was.
Yeah, like, oh, the moment they said a gratuitous cameo, I'm like, oh, yeah, Stan Lee's in this. I'm like, what was he getting? And then when he shows up as a stripper announcer, I'm like, yes, another great cameo from the great Stan Lee. He hasn't had a good one in a while.
We love you, mate.
Hmm?
What'd you think of Gina Carano, who was Angel?
Angel Dust, yeah. She was Gina Carano.
Yeah.
She was the chicken Fast and Furious 6.
So much else to say for her. Well,
no,
yeah, yeah.
She is the exact same she's been in for the last, what, 4 or 5 years in movies? That's okay.
Yeah, I guess it makes some sense. Like, you know, she's got that legit fighting background, so having her fighting Colossus adds a bit more credibility to it, I guess. But I did like the bit where she pops a boob. And
yeah,
Colossus
was,
is like,
that was great.
Ooh. Just on the left, and she's like, "Oh,
he's like,
thanks."
He's like, "Oh, you're so sweet," and then like
punches him right in the middle.
Yeah,
bowling
shot. I was like, "Oh man." I really wish I could say something Deadpool says whenever Colossus is like language, and he's like, "Sucka." No, that's a great kind of comeback. He's like, "Language." Oh, that was a great. Oh, I wish I could say it. Yeah, but I won't.
I also really liked the whole thing with that little mini subplot of the cab driver.
Oh yes, Doprendo, and then he had like the guy in his trunk.
Yeah,
it's like,
and he's like,
how?
Now
he's
you
like,
have to let him go, kill him,
so proud.
And then win back the girl with love, kidnap her.
That was so great. He's like, I'm so proud of you. Yeah, it was. That was great. You know, and then like, he gets into a car accident. Did you notice that he left his bag in the car? And I'm just like, oh, he left his guns in there again. And then he's just like, he's like, they're probably like, Mr. Poole, they get into an accident. The guy just gets crushed in the back. And you're just like, ooh. yeah. Another great. Yeah.
Oh, dear idea. Yeah, it was a great movie. I really loved it.
I think, yeah, like I said, when they do it right, it's wonderful. I think everything with Ryan Reynolds is great. He was born to play the role. TJ Miller's funny. Probably has some of the best lines in the movie, even though I heard it. Sorry.
Sorry, TJ Miller. My favorite line from him was, it actually wasn't really like, yeah, that funny, but I just loved it where he's like, you know, I would go with you, but I don't want to.
Yeah, it's a good. My favorite.
Because I've actually said that to people. I'd be like, yeah, I would do it, but I don't want to.
I don't want to. My favorite line from him is like, oh yeah, that creepy guy standing over there. He looks like he'll further the plot. That's my favorite. That's a good line from him. Yeah. Looks like he'll further the plot.
Looks like he'll further the plot.
I'm like, yes, that's wonderful. But I think. Like I said, all the Deadpool stuff works. You know, TJ Miller's lines of like, even that, even though we've heard it in the trailers, like, you look like you had sex with an older, angrier avocado, like, but like, there was no love in it. Like, it was just a hate, you know, that was great, you know. He's like, man, you look like Freddy Krueger, like, I took the topographical map of Utah. I was really sad there weren't any outtakes of that.
I guarantee there will be. I bet on the DVD there'll probably be like 15 minutes of that guy just riffing, coming up with all these different things.
But to be fair, they never put any extras on DVDs anymore, which is stupid. It's all on Blu-rays, even then the Blu-rays only have the trailers these days. But sorry.
Oh, side okay. Blu-rays then, yeah.
Yeah, side rant.
See, I should know that because I definitely do purchase all of my movies legally on Blu-ray. So
of course. We support the physical copy.
yes, which I'm sure will never be replaced by the digital medium at all.
Yeah, it's not like it's going to replace.
By the way, have you seen my new cassette tape Walkman? Yeah.
Hey, I want to shoot, baby. Hey,
I'm just getting a fax. Let me check it.
Oh, my God. He's like, yeah, I'll Hotmail you. I got you. Yeah.
Friendster. So, yeah, if they do time travel in the next one, which they will, wouldn't it be cool to see Deadpool actually in the 90s? Like, I could see him like walk into a toy store and there's all these troll dolls and he's just like, ah.
Or better yet, like he walks into this and he just sees all this stuff. He's like, man, this stuff is really stupid. Like he just walks around and he's just like, man, why did I like this? Is really dumb.
He's which like, one? Like, he looks at the camera. He goes...
Yeah, he looks. Or like he goes back to the 90s and the cameras look like how cameras looked back in the 90s or back in the 70s, you know, where he's just like, man, this is all terrible. Like, you know, like just as a brief kind of thing, like the same way where he flicks gum and he gets gum stuck on the camera lens, so he tears it off the camera lens, which is
that's like the first thing that happens, isn't it?
Yeah, like he just gets some gum off the ceiling, he's like flicks it around, gets it stuck in the camera. I'm like, man, they're going full on fourth wall break, and because that's the best thing about the character besides his snarkiness is the fact that he knows what he's in a comic movie, which is really well done.
Let me ask you because I think there's a bit I might have missed, is like in the final fight when he's killing all the henchmen, he recognizes one of the henchmen.
Yeah,
was that guy earlier in the movie?
I don't think so. I think that was just like, he was just a random friend. I think he was just like a random guy. Just I think
like one of the guys in the bar, or something.
My first thought was, is that a famous person I don't know? Is that a reference? Is that a cameo? Because I know like the first reference that I caught was, I think someone's badge said Rob L. And I'm like, oh, that's Rob Liefeld, the creator of Deadpool. And I remember I saw Rob Liefeld in that bar. Because I was just, at that point when they walked by, I'm like, okay, look for Easter eggs. Like, I think on the board, I think Donald Trump's name is on the board or something like that. So like, I think it's like Donald Trump and Bill Cosby or something like that. Like they're on the board. But
it's, Bill Cosby.
Yeah, it's like in the Deadpool. It's like, yeah. So you know, I was looking for reference. I think you can see Rob Liefeld in that bar, who was the creator of Deadpool. Apparently, he's a very cool guy. I don't know. Yeah.
Okay. Do you have any more thoughts? I thought maybe I missed something with that guy. Maybe he was a character or something. Or...
No, I think he's just a nice little side joke that I think worked really well.
Yeah. I guess because that makes sense because Deadpool, he would know how for the guns for hire in the city. So.
Yeah. He didn't actually kill him either. He's just like, oh, okay. Yeah. And like knocks the guy. He's like, hey, how's the wife? How's the kids? Good. Yeah. And then, yeah.
It's like in Austin Powers. People never think about what affects the family of a henchman.
Hello, I'm still alive down here. I'm going to try to walk. Ah! Oh, God!
Do you think they'll get Wolverine in the next one?
I think we'll get a cameo.
Yeah, they have
Even
to
Even though
at
Hugh Jackman had
cameo,
the best
right?
cameo in the movie. Hugh Jackman had a wonderful cameo at the end when he pulled off his mask.
Yeah.
And it was the cut face
that
of Hugh Jackman.
That was fantastic.
That was beautiful. That got an applause. He's like, oh yeah, I gotta move this one too, and just cuts to Hugh Jackman's face. I'd like to think that like Hugh Jack, like that was Ryan Reynolds just doing that for the sake of doing that. Like he had under there the whole time, and then like Miranda Baccarin's reaction is like her actual reaction. Like there are some times like characters start laughing about things. I'm like, huh, I wonder if that's improvised or not. Yeah, that was good movie. Good movie. I'm excited to see where it goes. I'm a little disappointed, but I'm excited to see where this goes. It's a nice step forward in a direction of getting a more original comic movies. So.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's good that they, you know, hopefully this sets a precedent similar to how in Guardians of the Galaxy in Marvel sort of set the precedent that it's okay to go a little bit wacky. Hopefully the same with all the Marvel properties owned by Fox will do this.
It's not
in Bryan Singer's movie, but in the other ones.
Exactly, which is my thing. It's like, it kind of like sets a thing of like the Marvel movies, like the Russo brothers should handle the Avengers movies. It makes sense because the Avengers movies are your event films. And I think this is the problem that they fell into with Phase 2 is that every solo film does not need to be an event movie. That's what the Avengers is for. You know, like you don't need – like the world doesn't need to be destroyed in every solo film. And I think that's what they need to try to avoid, because that's what made Guardians of the Galaxy so great. Because even though the universe was at stake, they were able to break it up with just these bits of humor, and the characters were so well written. Winter Soldier does the same thing until the third act, when it becomes the end of the world, essentially. Right. You know, and Ant-Man was able to keep it smaller, which why I think Ant-Man works so well. But, you know, and so, which is why I don't have a problem with Age of Ultron. I think the reason people aren't liking Age of Ultron is because it's not the same thing as the first movie. It's the same thing as every other Marvel movie out right now. And so when you have Fox doing X-Men, where it looks like the world's ending again, just like an Avengers movie, and then you have DC ending the world like they are in Man of Steel, you can see where people are like, oh, it's just the same thing over and over again. And this is Deadpool shows it like, no. You can break things up. You can make things different.
In the X-Men movies, it's not always they're going to destroy the world. It's always, I'm going to assassinate this president. I'm going to overthrow this government. come to think of it, I think X-Men Apocalypse is probably the first one where the actual world is in jeopardy.
But it looks like it's big budget bullets with a bunch of explosions and giant robots in the future past, or it's nukes falling towards the ground and blowing up in first class. Like, I'm not saying I have a problem with it. I'm just saying it does all look similar to a person who's not truly invested in all these universes. So, which is why when I see a trailer for X-Men Apocalypse, I'm like, this looks exactly like everything I've seen before. What do you have new for me? Which is why a movie like Doctor Strange or Thor 3 or Black Panther, God, Black Panther, has the opportunity to be something completely different. The movie's...
No, you make a good point, and I think that applies to like a lot of cinematic universes on the whole, is like they can follow the same format as the actual comic books do, where in like individual comic books for the individual characters, the superheroes are matched up with villains that are roughly their same power level. So, like if Superman's fighting Zod, or if Batman's going up against the Joker or Bane or whatever, Justice League only comes together when there is something threatening the whole world.
Exactly. So,
yeah, you're right. Like in movies as well, like in an individual Iron Man movie or whatever, you don't need to have the whole world in jeopardy every time. You can just fight, you know, whoever is his power level and just save the world blowing up for the Avengers, because that's what they're there for.
Exactly. And so, like, you know, which is why I think a movie like Captain or, oh my goodness, yeah. Like, which is why I can understand why people are now saying that Jessica Jones, they love it because it doesn't feel like a superhero show, which still sounds stupid to me, but I understand where they're coming at. I guess what they're saying now is, like, it doesn't feel like your everyday Marvel movie. Maybe if it wasn't so boring, but I think, you know, I understand where they're trying to get at now, and where Jessica Jones was a refreshing set of pace. But I feel like in the same way Daredevil is, and I feel like Daredevil did it a lot better. But I, like I said, Deadpool is a necessary step forward for Fox. I think they're going to let, hopefully this allows Fox to give people more control in their, in the creative department, because if you can get people that, if you can get this much passion around Deadpool, imagine if you get Matthew Vaughn back to do an X-Men movie. You can get one of the best movies in this genre to date. So, yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, that's, I'm just looking at my notes. That's pretty much everything I got to say.
Okay. All right. So, that's Deadpool, guys.
Excuse me. I'd like to ask you a few questions.
All right, so guys, this is the listener question segment of the podcast, in which me or Banda will post on both Facebook and Twitter, Movie Mania Podcast, in which you guys will ask us our listener questions, in which if they're good enough, we will answer them on the show, and you will get a shout out. All right, so on here on Facebook, Banda, do you want to go first or me to go first?
You go first, because I haven't pulled up the thing yet on my Facebook. So you go for it.
Okay. All right, well, Alex Lancaster asks, he says, do you think, since Deadpool was a massive success, is there a chance that Hugh Jackman's last movie as Wolverine could be rated R? I don't think so.
I actually think it will, because didn't they, with the Wolverine, they did it where it was like the sort of the more the rated M or whatever cut in cinemas, but then the DVD one was R? So they might finally pull the trigger and go R-rated.
Well, I think they released both cuts on DVD, or yeah, when they got to home video release. You know, originally it was PG-13 in cinemas, and then they they released it on DVD and whatnot, and they had the unrated cut, which basically just showed more blood and whatnot and violence. But I don't think, in the same way that we will never, that it'll be a bit before we get an R-rated Batman, because Wolverine, as much as we love the character, he's been around for 16 years at this point in the film universe as a PG-13 action hero. So I think it would be very jarring for his last outing to be an R-rated movie that kids would have to sneak into to see. It'd be a weird thing, because Wolverine's such a character that you see a bunch of little kids being Wolverine at this point. And because Wolverine's never been associated with, you know, R-rated violence and sex and nudity and all that stuff you associate with an R-rated action movie, I would love to see it, because I think it's something that Wolverine deserves as a character. But in terms of what Fox is actually going to end up doing, no, not for a bit. I think it'd give it 10 years and say this R-rated thing actually takes off, and like we get an X-Force, maybe an X-Force sequel, and those make a lot of money like Deadpool's doing, then we can probably get like R-rated Batman and all that. But give it time.
Yeah, yeah.
All right.
Well, it's Timothy John here. Says, yes. Who's a lesser known, by mainstream standards, comic book character that you guys would love to see get their own solo film one day? For me, apart from Martian Manhunter, which I've already talked about, yes. Plastic Man. Would love to see Plastic Man get a movie.
I could see that.
He would be like a kid-friendly Deadpool, because he's wacky, he's funny, he's over the top, he's colorful, but he's not usually known for all the sex jokes.
Yeah,
it'd be a kid-friendly Deadpool movie. That's basically what it would be.
I feel like I can't see Plastic Man without thinking of like animated. Like I feel like they'd have to do, like, go animation with Plastic Man, because he's always been either, you know, in the cartoons or Robot Chicken sketches. you know, so I don't know. I could see it. You know, in this age when they're doing Howard, they're like Mike. Christian turned to me during the movie or before the movie started. And he said, "How weird is it that we live in a universe where Howard the Duck and Daredevil live in the same universe?" And I'm like, excuse me, and I said, you're right. That's so weird. Yeah. So at this point, nothing would surprise me. You know? So, man, that's crazy.
That would
crazy.
Be great.
Like in Infinity War, you see Howard the Duck stand next to Daredevil.
I'd love to see Howard the Duck team up with the Punisher. That'd be great.
Yes. You take my money, because Howard the Duck's a violent character, man.
He and Deadpool
character.
Would actually do really well as a team up. Aren't
they both aware that they're in their comic book, right? Or is that She-Hulk? I don't know. Maybe one of those.
Yeah, She-Hulk also breaks the fourth wall. And she did it before Deadpool too, so.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I gotta answer the question. Well, we're pretty much all the characters. I'm not super dipped into the comic book knowledge. Pretty much, like, for a while, like, before they announced the Phase 3 movies of Marvel, I was like, we'll give Black Panther his own movie, give Captain Marvel her own movie, because, you know, those guys deserve their own, like, Miss Marvel, they deserve their own movies, but, you know, they're coming, I'm like, you know, Aquaman deserves some justice for quite some time. I'm glad he's finally getting what he deserves. In terms of none that they haven't announced yet, I'd really like to see Batman Beyond get kind of his own story, which I guess is, I know he's still kind of mainstream because of that cartoon show, but I think he really used something cool like Batman Beyond or Spider-Man 2099, you know, just kind of those, that futuristic kind of stuff, like the kind of Blade Runner meets superhero stuff we haven't seen yet. It'd be a nice take on the superhero genre. Give that to Bryan Singer. I'd see Bryan Singer do something like that. Yeah.
Sure.
All the black letter he wants.
We got a question here, Deadpool related. We probably should have covered it in the actual Deadpool because it might be spoilerish. Nah, it's not.
Is it Ewan David's question?
Well, you're more in tune with the spoilers. That's not really a spoiler, is it?
No, because
no. Well, okay, the question question is, do you want to see Deadpool's wife, I think she's just girlfriend, turn into the character Copycat in the sequel? That's all it is, because he's got a girlfriend who apparently becomes a...
well, yeah, she shares the same name as the character from the comics.
Well, she...
I mean, don't they have that line in the movie where, it might even be in the movie, it might just be in the trailer, she's like, you know, I played a lot of roles in my life, Damsel in Distress ain't one of them. You know, I'm okay with her becoming, I mean, it's point of a sequel is to up the stakes, so maybe to have kind of like, in the same way, like, how cool would it be, you know, they do kind of a parody of Ant-Man and the Wasp, you have Deadpool and Copycat, you know, maybe introduce Domino, establish that there are other characters like Deadpool out there where they're just as crass and violent and edgy as he is. It'd be nice to see, except they take themselves way too seriously. That'd be nice.
I guess a lot of people will probably disagree with this, because there's probably a lot of people who want to see Copycat, but I'd actually be okay with sitting out Deadpool's girlfriend for the next movie. Like, I liked her just fine in this. I love the actress who plays her. But, I don't know, I kind of have this feeling that by giving him, like, a proper girlfriend and being in a relationship will actually kind of hold him back in the next movie. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, I'd be okay if they find an excuse to get rid of her and then maybe bring her in next movie down the line or whatever.
Yeah. Kind of like the way that we don't see Pepper in the Avengers movies, and we're like, you know, she's there, but we don't need Tony Stark worrying about Pepper Potts all the time. Well, I think the whole crux of this movie was that it is a love story, and I just think that it'd be cool because it's a dynamic that we haven't seen before. It's a dynamic that we're not really going to see until Ant-Man and the Wasp of a kind of love story of
Deadpool loving himself, which he does several times in this movie.
That's a great line. I touched myself tonight. That's a great line.
Often
you know,
with a unicorn toy, which is very strange. But
yeah,
but you know, if you haven't seen the movie, you're going to be like, whoa, what? No, it's not as bad as it sounds.
Yeah, give it time. But I mean, you know, it's whatever they want to do. If they want to have a return as Copycat, that's completely fine by them, as long as they don't let it take away the character of Deadpool that you've established in this story. or as they say in the movie, sounds like a franchise, in this franchise. So yeah, okay.
Sure.
Martin Skage asked, he says, what's the funniest comic book movie? For me, it was Guardians of the Galaxy. Yeah.
You want me to answer first?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, for me, the funniest comic book movie is... Actually, technically, I'm not sure whether this would count as a comic book movie, because it's not really based off a comic book that I know of. But I like Mystery Men.
Oh, yeah.
That's one of my favorites, Mystery Men.
Yeah, I still haven't seen it, but I know it's one of your all-time favorite movies.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think that's one of the most funny. It's about loser superheroes, basically.
Yeah, you've talked about it several times.
But if I can't count that because it's not based off a comic book, I would go with Deadpool. I think it's been the funniest comic book movie I've seen in a really long time.
It is really funny. I think Guardians is a great one. I laughed a lot at the first Avengers. That first Avengers movie is really, really funny. Unintentionally funny, I will go... unintentionally funny, I can go...
Catwoman?
Catwoman, Blade 3, Spider-Man 3. A lot of the
Spider-Man 3 is very unintentionally funny.
Batman and Robin.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Done. Batman and Robin's the funniest comic movie out there. It's the happening of comic movies. It's the room of comic book movies. Where you're watching, you're like, man, this sucks. But it's not like Fantastic Four where it sucks just because it's so boring. It sucks because it's like, it's funny. It's fun to watch. So yeah, that's my answer.
I think that's all the questions we got. There's a couple other ones, but we already sort of answered it when talking about the movie. So I think that's all of them,
Yes. I do think we got them. Oh, well, there's one from SebPD that I think we should ask. What other superheroes should have an R-rated movie?
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, if they make the killing joke, that has to be R-rated.
Not necessarily.
Really?
Because it'll be a hard PG-13, but I think because if you go back and read the actual story, you never see Barbara Gordon naked. You never see like him actually naked. You never see Jim Gordon's genitals. You see Barbara Gordon get shot in the spine, but you never see Batman actually strangle the Joker. I know they've been talking about them doing the animated one R-rated. But those animated films are pretty much pushing the R-rated boundaries at that point. Like they're pretty much R-rated to a certain like Arkham or Sultan Arkham is pretty like gratuitous in some of their presentation. like if you're like you know cartoons, but still.
His head gets blown off by the thing, and then Joker picks up the head and he's like, oh.
I mean, I'm talking about the whole Harley Quinn thing, but that the violence is there too. The whole Harley Quinn Deadshot. The Harley Quinn Deadshot.
Oh, yes, that's right. Yeah,
that was a little... that was very jarring for me to see. I'm like, oh, okay.
Yahtzee,
very adult.
As she says.
Yahtzee. type Yahtzee in the comments. Batman is one I definitely like to see get an R-rated movie. I like to see Spawn. If they're going to do Spawn again, make him R-rated. Some of the more grittier movies, like maybe if you ever bring Daredevil into the MCU, like the cinematic world, then you know, give him his own movie, make it R-rated. I think if you do Black Widow, you can do Black Widow R-rated. Really? I really think you do, like, because she's a spy. She kills people.
She's still kid-friendly spy. It'd be weird to go.
Well, she doesn't have any toys.
R-rated with her.
She doesn't have any toys. I don't see the issue.
She could. You don't know. She could have unicorns.
Yeah. Oh my. there are plenty of characters out there that should get their own R-rated movie. I think like I said, Deadpool definitely has opened the floodgates to see what kind of, like, my bigger question is that I'd like to see kind of bigger directors take on a superhero movie. As of right now, the biggest director we've seen make one is Kenneth Branagh. Like, he's the big Shakespeare guy. He came in and took on the superhero genre with the first Thor. I want to see Scorsese do a Batman movie.
Mm.
I think that'd be cool. I don't know. I don't know. He's never been really one to do action super. He knows how to do fight scenes. You know, he did boxing scenes really well in Raging Bull. But I mean, you give Scorsese Batman, that's such a cool idea. I don't know. I'm rambling.
Yeah, I'd be down with that.
Yeah. Okay. All right. I think that is the last question on Facebook here. You said there are no more on Twitter.
No, there's none on the Twitter page.
Okay. All right. Well, I think that closes out today's episode.
Indeed it does.
Okay. Wait a minute, Bennett. I think there might be a delay.
No. I just paused because I thought you were
going
to keep
going. Okay. All right. Sorry. Okay. Never mind. Okay. So, thank you guys all for watching. Join us next week when we are talking The Dark Knight Rises. Thank you for listening to us talk about Deadpool and Game of Thrones, even though Skype has been kind of bonkers today. Bandit, where can people find you?
The people can find me on YouTube and Facebook and Twitter as Bandit Incorporated, and they can find you.
They can find me on YouTubes, Twitters, Facebooks, all that at either Trey White or Podcast Media. Such thanks to Milan Jeftik for the artwork. Praise IG Boar. I do not praise you, traitor. But come back next week when we talk Dark Knight Rises, and thank you for watching Movie Maniacs.